we got orders to fly to Puerto Rico. So from Puerto Rico, you went in, and they gave you orders down to Georgetown, British Guiana. And from there, we went down through Brazil, and from Brazil, we flew over to Ascension Islands, which is over toward Africa. Then we had a good idea where we were going. And from there, we went to Dakar, Africa, and from Dakar all the way up to Marrakech. And that's where I had to stay with the plane that night. And the guy came out to gas it up, and his equipment didn't work. So he gave me 800 gallons of gas to put in the plane by, they were like a couple gallon cans, you know, like air bases and even ships on the Mediterranean and different all kind of targets. While we were there, we had our plane was hit pretty bad. We had over 200 holes in it, and we didn't have no hydraulic system, so we couldn't get the wheels down and couldn't get no flaps or nothing like that. So we had a good pilot. He was a full-blooded Indian from Kansas City. Well, I'll name the rest of the crew right away. His name was John White. And then the co-pilot, he was from Atlanta, Georgia. And our bombardier, he was from Texas. And then we had the tail gunner. He was from Baltimore. And he had a bad habit, whiskey and women.
That's two bad habits.
And well, it was, we ruined the plane. I mean, it was completely destroyed. And then we got that, well, our first plane, you can name your plane whatever you want, every plane was named different, and they'd paint a picture on it and all that. So then we went.
Well, what was the name of your plane?
Hellcat.
Hellcat.
And then we got another plane, Hellcat the second we had.
That was after the first one was shot up?
Yeah.
Let me go back to the Sahara for just a moment, because, I mean, that's hard to believe that you guys had one canteen full of water a day.
That's all we had.
I mean, how did you make that last?
Well, we used to take it along up in the plane when we went up, because then we'd cool it off, see? Because it got real cold up there when you're up pretty high. So we'd cool it off that way. But that's all. Well, it was 3 months. It seemed pretty long, but it got used to it. And then,
Well, before you go any further, I want to talk about Rommel a little bit. Rommel's desert campaign, with Germans wearing those uniforms we've seen that, not the greens, but the, you know, the ones that are supposed to match the, I don't know, they're not camouflage, but with the desert, the light color uniforms.
Yeah.
Did you?
A lot of us cut our pants off and made shorts out of them. Mm-hmm. Where we were at, because our commanding officer said, don't ever salute me because I'm not saluting you back. We're not here to salute, we're here for one thing. And he was really good.
Now, when you say that you went after Rommel on a regular basis, you're talking about the tank corps, I assume.
Well, we had target, like air bases, even from, we had quite a few trips even across the Mediterranean into Italy and southern France.
Yeah. Did you inflict some damage?
Oh yeah, we did. We inflicted, you know, and we, like, we'd even, like, air, well, a couple of airplane factories and that like that. And what we did, we'd drop, two different kind of bombs, delayed fuses, and then some that would go off right away, because especially like at a factory or something where people were working, They golf one day and they think it's over, and the next day they golf. They had 24-hour delayed fuses on. And we had, and my job was always, I was the closest one to the bomb bay, so about a half an hour before we got to the target, I'd have to get in and pull cotter pins out, because, see, they're all armed, and I mean, they're not armed until you pull the cotter pin, and then the propeller got to go around so many times, and when it comes off, then it's ready to explode. So I'd always have to get in and do that. Now, when we flew, we carried a, in fact, I have one with me. It's a compass, about as big as your fingernail. And that, you were supposed to keep it hidden. And then we had a silk map inside our flight suits that would tell you if you bailed out or had a crash land or anything. And if you could keep from getting caught, then you're just supposed to travel at nighttime. And they had farmhouses that had wash hanging on the line a certain way. And if it was, and you carried a wallet, a sealed wallet that you didn't know how much, but it was a lot of money in. And then you went in and you gave it to them. They were, you know, working for us. And then at a certain date and that you got to a certain place, they'd see that you got there, and then they'd send a little boat in for you.
You have any close calls? I mean, you mentioned the ship, you mentioned the plane getting shot
yeah.
200 times, but did you have any other?
I had a turret dome taken off at one time, a plexiglass, that was hit, and then I had to get down out of it because the area was too great, you couldn't. And sometimes you thought that anti-aircraft fire, you could see them when they exploded down below, and they have a certain height that they can set them. They send usually a fighter and stays out of your range, and then he gets your same altitude, and they keep setting them, and you keep going up and down until the bomb run. For 30 seconds, you had the bombardier took over the plane then. And you had to keep it perfect level till you dropped your bombs, and then you head back again.